Okay, welcome to Mechanical Engineering Systems. In today's class, I want to extend the discussion that we had in the last class and talk about twisting or torsion. So this is design of shafts, couplings, keys, and other torsional elements. Now, before we begin, what I want to do is I want to write down the expression for moment. Moment is given as force times distance, or force times radius. Now, there are two types of moments. One is bending moment, and the other is twisting moment. Now let me try to explain the difference between these two moments. And this is the review of the material that you studied in your previous classes. So I want you to understand that this is a machine element. And on this machine element, we are applying force vertically. What would happen is, because of this force, this element is going to bend downwards. And it's very critical to know that the word is bending. So this is bending. Same thing, if you were to apply the force in the horizontal direction, that would cause this element to bend like this. So again, this is bending. Now I want you to think about a case wherein the force is applied radially. F is applied radially. This force is going to twist this element. So basically, this will cause twist. So what that means is you have bending when the force is applied in XX or YY plane, and you have twist when the torque is applied about ZZ plane. So again, the concept is the same, force multiplied by distance, but depending upon where this moment is acting, whether the moment is causing the element to bend or the moment is causing that element to twist, you would use the equation for bending or equation for torsion. Now, in this class, we are not going to ask you to derive the equations. The focus would be on applications and using these equations to solve design problems. So let's start with what we know. We know for bending, the equation is M divided by I is equal to sigma divided by Y. As you know, M is the bending moment. Sigma is tensile or compressive stress. I is the moment of inertia. And y is the distance from neutral axis. Now for torsion, the structure of the equation is also same. So structure is the same. T divided by J is equal to tau divided by R, which is similar to M divided by I is equal to sigma divided by Y. But now T is twisting moment. Tm is twisting moment or torque. J is polar moment of inertia. Tau is the shear stress. And R is the distance or the radius. So in the case of torque, it's a radial distance. So the distance from the center line. So the equations are similar, but the applications are slightly different. And if you think about the shaft, so let's understand the difference between rods and shafts. So rods and shafts. Rods are used to transmit forces or moment. Shafts are used for transmission of torque and or twisting moment. Both of these can be used for power transmission. So this is the first thing. So, but the power transmission by rods is force multiplied by velocity. And power transmitted by shafts is torque multiplied by angular velocity. And I need to explain this here. So example, you have a rod that is acted upon by an engine, and you have a slider on the other side. So you have force and then you have velocity. For torque, you have a shaft and maybe you have a pulley. And what you have is torque T, and then you have omega. Just to give you omega, omega is given by 2 pi n by 60, where n is in RPM. Now, typically, rods could be rectangular, square, so rectangular, square, or circular. Shafts, most of the times, about 90% of the shafts that you will see, they are circular. The equations for rods, sigma is equal to M divided by I multiplied by Y. And for shafts, E divided by j multiplied by r. And at this point, I just want to give you a side note on what is this j. J is called as the polar moment of inertia. And what is I? I is just moment of inertia. Now, a step back. So if you look at bending, it's because of the force applied around XX or around YY. So moment of inertia in this particular case would be IXX or IYY. So it could be moment of inertia about XX or moment of inertia about YY. On the other hand, if you look at the moment about G, J is nothing but moment of inertia about G. So J is nothing but IGG. And remember this famous equation, if you have not studied it before, IGZ is equal to IXX plus IYY. Now, in almost all the cases, our shafts and couplings are going to be circular. So let me give you the expression for IGZ is equal to J for a circular cross section, which is pi d raised to 4 by 32. Assuming it's a solid cross section. The other thing is, if you have a hollow cross section, it would be pi d outside the power 4, d inside the power 4 by 32. And a quick check, if you look at for circular cross section, IXX and IYY. This is a side note. IXX and IYY is pi d to the power 4 by 64. So I can say IGG is IXX plus IYY, which is 2 times pi d raised to 4 by 64. That gives me the same expression as pi d raised to 4 by 32. So this is something that you should keep in mind. Now, before we start looking into design of shafts or design of elements that can be used to transmit power, which is torque times angular velocity, let me give you the expression for power. Power is T multiplied by omega, that is given in watts, T times 2 pi N divided by 60, where N is revolution per minute, also called as RPM. So what this equation does is it takes the revolution per minute and divides this by 60, that you get revolution per second. Now, how do we design a shaft or any circular element? So please understand, bending moment or bending stresses are tensile or compressive. Bending does not cause shear stress. So remember, no shear, no direct shear, I should say, no direct shear. Twisting stresses they are always shear stresses. So when you have a shaft, the shaft design is always based on the shear strength. So this is something important. Strength is the ability of the material to withstand or resist load. It is different than the stress, because please understand, stress is given by load by area. But if this stress is less than equal to the strength of the material is okay. For some reason, if this stress that is generated because of external load and the geometrical properties exceeds the value of the strength of the material, then the material would fail. And that precisely is the rationale behind different failure theories. So what that means is material strength, it characterized by different ways material can fail. So potentially material can fail in the principal stresses, or material can fail in maybe shear stresses. So depending upon the type of failure that is observed in the material, you could have different strength or failure theories. So failure theories provides us a rational justification of using certain values in our design calculations. Now, when you study finite element analysis, because when you go to industry, you will use either SolidWorks or Autodesk Inventor. Or you would use ANSYS, or you will use Nastran, or you'll use Abacus to do something called as finite element analysis. And as part of the quizzes, I ask you to try to experiment with this type of analysis, which means there are guidelines, and I gave you line by line tutorials, video information, video tutorials that you can watch and try to repeat or duplicate the results. But almost always, when you go in industry, you are going to use some sort of CAD software for drawing, and some sort of CAE software, computer aided analysis, or computer aided engineering software to find stresses and deflection and so on. So some familiarity with SolidWorks would be very helpful when you go to industry. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna give you a recipe for shaft design. And as we go through the material, we will try to make adjustment for key weakening and other stuff in the shaft. So how do we design the shaft? So this is the procedure for design of shafts. And before I begin, let me quickly ask, have you studied shaft design as part of EGR 444 or maybe EGR 341, mechanics of material class? I'm looking at the chat window. Okay, so So I will explain this step by step, and I will also work out the problems that will give you some confidence. And the problem that I'm going to work out will be similar to the homework problem. So when you design a shaft, here is what we are trying to do. We are trying to design a circular member. It could be solid or hollow that is connected between, for this particular case, I'm going to say there is a motor. So there is a motor here, electrical motor. And maybe this is connected to a pump. So this is a pump. And this shaft needs to transmit the torque and the power from this electrical motor to pump. Now, it is not a good engineering practice to have a super long shaft between the electrical motor and the pump. Because if you think about it, this shaft in the motor, there will be actually a rotor and stator and all that stuff. So usually what you have is, you have something called as the coupling. So there is a coupling on the electric motor. There is going to be coupling on the pump, and there will be bearings for the shaft to support the load. So this would be some sort of a setup that you'll encounter. So there will be bearing. So you will have bearings supporting the shaft. You will have couplings that connect shaft of the electric motor to the transmission shaft to the pump shaft. Now, many a times, there could be a clutch. So there is a potential for clutch. Now, why do we need a clutch? Because if you think about it, the way the motor is designed, it is supposed to start at no load, just like an engine. Just to give an example, think about an internal combustion engine or your car engine. That car engine basically is connected to the shaft, that is a transmission shaft, and then there is something called as the clutch with multiple plates. So there is a clutch, and then there is this coupling. And there is maybe transmission gearboxes and all that stuff. So there is a gearbox. This is a gearbox. This is engine. So what is different in this setup? So the clutch here is clutch. This is an additional part. This clutch allows engagement and disengagement. So when you are starting the engine, you want to start the engine at no load, because you will never start engine at load, because that would increase the torque, speed, the characteristics or requirement super high. When the engine picks up speed, it is able to produce the torque, then you attach or you somehow you clutch or you connect these clutch plates. So you could have a spring over here, and you could have a lever that would actually exert the force on the spring for declutching. So as soon as you release the pedal, maybe this is the foot. As soon as you release the pedal, then the clutch is engage. And if you have experience in driving manual car, this is how the setup is. Initially, the car is started in the neutral. So when you are in the neutral gear, the engine is decoupled from transmission. It's also called a transmission. And then the engine is started. So engine starts at no load. Then what happens is you actually release the first you change the gear, maybe to the first gear, and release the clutch. The releasing clutch leads to gradual engagement of power. Now, I don't know if you have tried this or not. If you let the clutch pedal go suddenly, then you'll realize the vehicle would jump and most likely would stop, because the engine cannot provide the instantaneous power that is needed at in that small fraction of time. So once you allow the engine to engage gradually, in that case, the power transmission smoothly increases and then it actually goes up. So this is how the engagement and disengagement takes place. Oh, a just quick note here. Dr. Sushil Kumar has joined. So I just want to let you know that Dr. Sushil Kumar will be teaching next three lessons. Dr. Sushil, you want to quickly introduce yourself? And I have told them that you'll be emailing them the link for the Zoom call, so they can log into the Zoom call and then attend your lesson. So for next three lessons, Dr. Sushil will be teaching you the material. So I'm going to ask him to unmute. Sushil, you are welcome to say a few words.
Hi, hello class. Hi all. Hi, this is Sushil. Some of you guys know me. Some of you guys may not know me. But I will be happy to go over the topics for the next three lectures, and I will be emailing you with a Zoom link the earliest as an announcement through Canvas. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Sushil. And Sushil's email is in the Canvas, so you're welcome to send him an email. Or Sushil, if you want, you can just type your email in the chat window for everyone to note down. Okay. All right. Thank you, Sushil. So now for selective engagement and disengagement, you can actually use a clutch. Now, the advantage of clutch is you can, so for example, when you're starting the engine, what you do is you declutch the engine from the transmission, change the gear, and then engage the engine. So if you start your vehicle, maybe you want to get into the first gear, then maybe you want to get into the second gear, maybe you want to get into the third gear. For automatic transmission, this is all done automatically. There are hydraulic valves and cylinders and fluid that actually increases the pressure on one side of the clutch, decreases the pressure on the other side of the clutch, and all these engagement and disengagement smoothly happens without even you noticing it. But if your transmission, automatic transmission, is bad, then you will feel the jerks as the transmissions get changed. So when you go from first to second, if there is issue with your transmission, you will feel a jerk. That is the issue with engagement or disengagement. So clutch design also is based on the design of shafts. And if time permits, I will talk to you about the clutch design, because when you study engines, clutch is an integral part that allows engine to be connected, or any prime mover, electric motor, or any prime mover to a load, so load like pump, gearbox, car, and so on. So going back to our problem statement, design of shafts, usually you will know the power, you will know the tau, which is the shear strength of the material. This is the maximum shear stress the material can withstand. Max shear stress material can withstand. And then P is the power to be transmitted, and N the speed. There are variations to this procedure, but we'll start with a very simple procedure and then gradually modify this. So first and foremost, what you will do is you will use the equation for power. P is equal to 2 pi NT divided by 60. And from this equation, you will find out the value of torque in Newton meter or Newton millimeter. The second equation is tau is equal to T divided by J multiplied by R, where R is the radius. So J is pi D raised to 4 by 32, assuming it's a solid shaft. R is D by 2. So for short distances and low power, typically for short distances, we use solid shaft. But many a times, if you have an engine, say if you have a truck, and I would encourage you to take a look at the truck that is not moving, you will see that there is something called as the prop shaft. So basically, there is a shaft with a universal joint that is connected from the front of the truck, that is engine, to the rear wheels. This is called as the prop or the propeller shaft. And this is hollow. And the reason this shaft is hollow, because if you were to use a solid shaft this long, most likely it would be heavy. And because of the weight and the mass, there will be significant inertial load. Balancing is going to be difficult, and then it will vibrate violently if you haven't balanced it. And then think about it, that you are going to have this truck going maybe on a terrain that is rough, and at that time you don't want these imbalances to cause instability in the trucks. So for short distances, you can actually look at the solid shaft. When the shaft distances are large, then we can use the hollow shaft. The design procedure is the same. Now, time to work out a problem. Any questions before we start the problem? Yes, four power shift, you can Google and take a quick read, and you will see why flush design is very important. Okay, let me start with a very simple problem first. So let's design a shaft. The power to be transmitted is 20 kilowatts. Speed is 200 RPM. We can assume the shaft to be made with mild steel. And at this point, you can use the design data book. You can see the table and then find out the design strength of the mild steel. Or in this case, let me give that to you. This is the tau design. It's 42 megapascals. And we looked at the relationship between megapascals. So 42 newton per meter square, which is same as 42 newton per millimeter square. Just remember this. So now what we are going to do is, using step one, P is equal to 2 pi n P divided by 16. So 20 kilowatts, 2 times pi, n is 200 divided by 60 multiplied by T. So this gives the value of torque. And please your calculators, and you will see the value of torque is 955 Newton meter. Why do I get Newton answer in Newton meter? Because this power is in watts. Now I need to convert this into Newton millimeter, because my strength is in Newton per millimeter square. Step two, tau is equal to T divided by J multiplied by R. Tau is 42, T is 955 power 3, pi d raised to 4 by 32, T by 2. So as you can see, the only unknown in this equation is D, which is the diameter of the shaft. So when you solve, you will say diameter is 48.5 millimeter, and we approximate it to 50 millimeters. Now this is a design class, so it is not possible to machine a shaft which is of 48.5 millimeter diameter. So what we do is we'll round it up on the higher side. And the purpose of rounding is this shaft size is readily available for purchase. It's called a catalog item. So you can go to DigiKey, you can go to Amazon, or perhaps you can go to eBay, and then this shaft size would be available. If you look at the design data book, there are standards. And these standards give you the preferred shaft sizes. So what you can do is you can actually look at the book, design data book, or you can look at machinery's handbook, or you can look at the catalog item at McMaster, or maybe Granger. And then you will see the standard shaft sizes that are available. Many a times, once you visit these vendors, they will not only provide you with the standard sizes, but they will also provide you with the CAD models of those parts that you could directly integrate in your design. So always using a catalog item or the ready-made item is better. Okay, any questions here? Let me take one more problem. So in here, we are going to design solid shaft and hollow shaft. So design solid shaft and hollow shaft, and they have given us for the hollow shaft the ratio of B inside to B outside is 0.5. So we have to design a shaft wherein the inside diameter and outside diameter, they are in the ratio of 0.5. So inside diameter is half of the outside diameter. In this case, the problem is worded slightly differently. What it means his power is equal to 20 kilowatts, speed is 200 RPM, but ultimate shear strength is equal to 360 megapascal, and factor of safety is equal to 8. So I just want to tell you the difference between this problem and the problem that we are solving, we just solved. So here the keyword is ultimate. So ultimate shear strength is given as 360 megapascal, which means that is the maximum strength that shaft is able to sustain, assuming there are no discontinuities, there are no defects, there is nothing. The shaft is homogeneous, continuous, no heat treatment issues, no surface impurities issues, no issues related to cracks, blow holes, voids. But in actual practice, it is almost impossible to find such a pure material. And even if we find this pure material, that would be super duper expensive. So what we do is, to compensate for uncertainties, we find out something called as the design strength. So tau design is equal to tau ultimate divided by factor of safety. So this is 360 divided by 8. And when we do that, we have the value of shear strength design 45 Newton per millimeter square. Because please understand, 360 megapascal is 360 Newton per millimeter square. Now the procedure is exactly same as the previous problem. Step one, P is equal to 2 pi NT divided by 60. Now the power is 20 into the power 3. 2 pi N is 200 times T divided by 60. That gives you the value of torque. And same value, 955, 10 to the power 3 Newton per Newton millimeter. Second thing, if we want to use the equation tau is equal to T divided by J multiplied by R. First case, solid shaft, strength is 45, it is 955, 10 to power 3, multiplied by D by 2, divided by pi D raised to 4, pi 32. Second case, in the case of hollow shaft, same equation, except now we will use the equation DO outside diameter by 2 divided by pi D outside to the power 4 minus D inside to the power 4 by 32. So we just modified the equation for the moment of inertia for the hollow shaft. This is the same equation that we wrote a moment ago. This is the equation for the hollow shaft. And DO is the maximum radius. This is where the torsional stress is going to be maximum. That's why we have DO by 2. Now we have to use this relationship, which is DI divided by DO is equal to 0.5. And then you will realize that you will only have one unknown. And when you substitute for the solid shaft, you will get 47.6 50 millimeters. And for hollow shaft, you are going to get BO at 48.6 and DI. So I'm going to modify this to 50, and DI is equal to 50 by 2 is equal to 25 millimeters. Now, this exercise is a little bit intuitive. And I want you to think about, and I want you to develop the intuition a little bit. So when we looked at the solid shaft design, from design calculations, my shaft design gave me 47.6 millimeter as a solid shaft diameter. When I looked at the hollow shaft from the design, it still gave me 48.6 millimeter, which means there is slight increase, not too much. I mean, it's about 1 millimeter in diameter. But here, if you were to look at the weight of the shaft, I promise you that weight of the hollow shaft will be significantly less compared to the weight of the solid shaft. So here, you are going to have weight savings. So weight saving. So when you have a solid shaft, if it's a small distance, you would use a solid shaft, or if you have to cut splines, solid shafts are better. But if you are going to use the shaft over a large distance, then the preference would be to go for the hollow shaft. Any questions about the problem here, the problem that we worked out? Now, let me add a little bit more complexity to the problem. Now, let's look at how the shaft is typically structured. So if you were to look at the transmission or a shaft, so you will have a shaft that is attached between two bearings. So you will have bearings, and this shaft is going to have non-trivial weight. So this shaft is going to be heavy. Many a times you would have some sort of gear, you will have some sort of pulley, some sort of belt on this shaft. So what's going to happen is, on this shaft, you are going to have an external load, which is W. This W is the self weight. Of shaft plus maybe weight of gear, pulley, etc. So now if you look at in the front view, you will see the free body diagram, something like this. This is the external load W, and the bearing will give you the reactions R1 and R2. And apply the conditions of static equilibrium, you can find out these bearing reactions. Assuming this distance is L by 2, this is the center span, this distance is L by 2. And say, let me give you an example, weight is maybe 1000 newtons or 100 kilograms. Then the reaction here will be 500 newtons, reaction here will be 500 newtons. Now, I want you to understand the case when the shaft is not transmitting the power. So the case number one is the shaft is not transmitting the power. So whether the shaft is transmitting power or the shaft is not transmitting power, there is going to be some type of bending. So this shaft will be bent. This shaft will be bent. Which means right now, because of the self weight, this shaft will be subjected to bending stresses. So you have to find out the bending stresses on shafts. bending stress on shaft. You have to have compressive or tensile stresses, and you will use the equation M divided by I multiplied by Y, and the bending, this is the bending moment, which is the moment of R1. This is where the maximum bending moment would happen. And in case, if you are a little bit uncertain on how to draw the bending moment diagram, just take a look at the material in the textbook. It will give you some bending moment diagrams for standard loads. So bending moment is going to be R1 multiplied by L by 2. Force multiplied by distance, which is nothing but M. Now, I, this is actually the bending stress. So I is going to be pi d raised to 4 by 64. And pi d raised to 4 by 64, please note, not 32. This is super important. Not 32. Because this is not J. This is I. This is not J. So I. And Y is going to be D by 2. So what you would do is, you would plug in the values for the bending moment. You would plug in or find the values for I, you will plug in the values of Y, and you will get the answer for bending stress. So find sigma. So assuming the dimensions are given, this is the process that you will follow. Now, let me take a step back and say, if I want to design, which means the stress values are given. So this is slightly problem structured differently. This value is given, loads are given, and you have, just like the shaft problem, you have to find out the dimensions using this equation. So you can actually reverse the procedure that we did and then find out the dimension of the shaft. Now, what I want to do is, I want to take a simple example. And the reason for that example is the next part. We are going to talk about the case when the shaft is not stationary. So I just want to tell you here something important. It is a stationary shaft. So this shaft is stationary, not rotating, not transmitting forward. So let's take an example, and then we can actually work out this problem real quick. So consider the shaft shown in the picture. And there are end loads on this shaft. So think about it, that you have a shaft. And maybe there are gears on one side. This gear on the other side, and those gears are heavy. So this is how, and there are bearings here. So these are bearings. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about here is, just let me give you some dimensions. This dimension is 100 millimeters. this dimension is 100 millimeters. This distance is 1.4 meter. So this is kind of a long shaft. And what we want to do is we want to design this shaft just for stationary loads. So it is sort of a misnomer that the shaft for stationary loads, usually shafts are not designed for stationary loads, but since the, if there is no torque that is transmitted, the shaft is going to be stationary, but nevertheless, all the loads like self weight, the weight of the external components, pulleys, gears, everything is going to be on this shaft. So one thing that I want you to think about is that there is external load happening, and but shaft has not started rotating. So there is no torque transmission here. The other way to talk about it is maybe this is just sort of an idler shaft, which is like, think about it like this is an axle with the dummy wheels. That means the wheels are rotating, but they are not powered. The wheels are sort of just stationary. They are rotating, but there is no torque applied to it by engine. So maybe just an axle, but that axle is not powered. So here, the stress, design strength tau is given as 100 megapascals or 100 newton per millimeter square. Okay, I just want to let you know, Sushil has emailed you all about the Zoom link for the lecture. And please join that Zoom link for the next four classes, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So yes, for next four classes, please join that Zoom link. So you have 100 megapascals. Now what I want to do is, since there is no torque, which is super important, no torque. So I'm gonna draw the bending moment diagram, or at least let me draw the forces. Please note, this is a symmetric distributed load. So if you look at the center line, the load on the left-hand side is equal to load on the right-hand side. The loading is symmetric. The reactions are symmetric, which means you are gonna have equal and opposite reaction to the load. So you are gonna be 50, 50, 50, 50. And this distance is 100. And the maximum bending moment, since the loading is symmetric, loading and geometry symmetric, the maximum bending moment will be at center. The maximum bending moment is going to be here. So this is 100, is 1.4, so 700 millimeters. So the bending moment maximum is 50 newton, kilonewton is being counterclockwise. This 50 kilonewton is going clockwise. So you have 50 multiplied by 710 minus 50 multiplied by 700. That gives you 50 times 10 kilonewton millimeter is the effective bending moment that is acting on the shaft. And we want the bending moment to be in newton millimeter. So 500 times 10 to the power 3 newton millimeter is the bending moment acting on the shaft. And the process is exactly similar. So sigma is equal to m divided by I multiplied by y. Sigma is 100. Please note this sigma, not tau. Not tau. Because this is not the shear stress problem. This is the bending stress problem. M is 500, only 10 multiplied by 10 to the power 3. I is 5d raised to 4 by 32 d by 2. Oh, made a mistake. It's not 32. That's what I thought. 66. 500, 10 to the power 3 divided by pi d to the power 4 by 64 multiplied by d by 2. And with this, we should be able to find out the value of B, and value of B is 79.8 millimeter. So approximately 80 millimeter. So this is something that you should keep in mind. Any questions here? Now, next case that I want to talk about, and this case is super important because this sets the stage for the gear design. This sets the stage for the complex loading on shaft and so on. So now consider a case where the torque and bending moment, they are acting simultaneously. Now let me set up the problem. So consider that here is a shaft. And on the shaft, there is this pulley, there is this gear, and the bearings are here. But this shaft is attached to an electrical motor or some sort of prime mover. And then maybe you have another gear that is attached to some other generator. So you have gear and that is attached to the generator. And maybe you have a pulley that is transmitting power to a different shaft. So something like this. So you have configuration that is something like this. Now, what we want to do is we want to design this shaft. So the diameter of the shaft is D. When the shaft is not rotating, this shaft is subjected to the stationary load. So let me draw the free body diagram. So for example, there is this load. Now, one thing I want to tell you is that this load, which is in vertical direction, and there is another load, which is in the horizontal direction. And maybe there are bearings here and here. Now, as you can see, these two loads, one is in vertical direction, and second load is in horizontal direction. So these two loads will give you a resultant force that will lead to a resultant bending moment. So what it means is in this particular case, is super important. In this case, we have vertical loads and horizontal loads. So we have to find bending moment in vertical direction and I would work out the problem, and we have to find the bending moment in horizontal direction. So I'm going to call this BMB and BMH. And then we will have a resultant bending moment, which would be the square root of bending moment in vertical direction, bending moment in horizontal direction. And this bending moment will be used for design of shafts or finding out the diameter. But nevertheless, the equation is going to be sigma is equal to Bm resultant I multiplied by y. Now, let's assume that this now starts rotating. So in addition to the bending load, it's going to have a torque. So now, so addition to bending, there will be twisting moment. Now, what does that mean? So bending moment is going to give rise to sigma. Twisting moment is going to give rise to shear. So you are going to have normal stresses and you are going to have shear stresses. And this is the classic case when you have simultaneous action of normal stress and shear stress. Normal plus shear stress give you principal stress, and maximum shear stress. So think about it like a resultant. So you have the normal stress that is acting perpendicular to the element, and you have the shear stress that is acting parallel to the element. So since these two are not aligned, they are at 90 degrees to each other, so you have something called as the resultant, which is the combination of normal and shear stress. So this gives you a principal stress. So when you have the shafts that are subjected to combined loading. So this is shaft subjected to combined loading. This is combined. There is concept of principal stress. So what we need to do is we have to find out the principal stress, we have to find out the maximum shear stress, and then use the equations to find out the dimension. However, there is a trick. So there is a trick. So please understand, this is a design problem. This is not a mechanics of material problem. So we can take a shortcut to solve these types of problems. And I will discuss that when we come back after 15 minutes. So I'm going to give you all a break for 15 minutes. And after we come back about 2:30 to 2:35, I will talk about how to solve these types of problems. Okay, a break for 15 minutes. So now here is a fundamental question. If we have a complex loading condition, such as you have loads in the horizontal direction, load in the vertical direction, and maybe torque, how do we solve this problem? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the classical method that is described in the book, and then I will talk about a shortcut method that also works. So you are welcome to use any of those two methods. Out of those two methods, you can use either the classical method or the shortcut method. I tend to use the shortcut method because it gives the same answers and quicker. You don't have to do any approximations or solve the equation using trial and error. So let me start the process of solving a problem with combined loads. So what we have is, here is the problem. Design a shaft, and this could be solid or hollow. For combined loading. When I say combined loading, I need to clarify, which means you have bending and torsion simultaneously acting. So step one is find out resultant bending moment. Find resultant bending moment. And this is denoted as BMR. And this BM can be found out by the usual process, drawing the free body diagram, looking where the bending moment is maximum, and finding out the maximum bending moment. If you have loading in two different planes, so for example, you have loading in the horizontal plane, and if you have loading in the vertical plane, then what you want to do is you want to draw the bending moment diagram in the horizontal plane, and you want to draw the bending moment diagram in vertical plane, and then see where the maximum bending moment is taking place. Because the bending moment in the horizontal direction would be different than the bending moment in the vertical direction. The resultant bending moment might very well be different depending upon where the result maximum value is reached. So for an example, if you have a bending moment in the vertical direction that shows two peaks here, and the bending moment in the horizontal direction shows only one peak here, but understand the resultant bending, to find the resultant bending moment, you have to find out the resultant bending moment at point A, you have to find out the resultant bending moment at point B, you have to find out the resultant bending moment at point C. And out of these three points, so you have bending moment, A, resultant at A, bending moment resultant at B, and bending moment resultant at C. And out of these, you have to choose the maximum bending moment. So this problem becomes tricky if you have a super complicated loading condition. But you will see that very rarely we have a problem where the loading condition is super complex. Most of the times, especially in gears and other cases, the forces are pretty straightforward to resolve. So just keep this in mind. So once we have this, we have to, and assuming sigma value is known, bending moment resultant divided by value of I multiplied by D by 2 in the case of solid shafts. Recognize this value is known. This value will come from here. Value of I and D will be expressed in terms of D. So this entire expression at the end of the day will be in terms of D. And D is the unknown. So you could have maybe a square equation or a cubic equation, depending upon whether the shaft is hollow or solid. But what I'm trying to say here is you will have the sigma in terms of D. Now, next question is, if you have torsion, so for the torsion, you would find out the value of tau using the equation T divided by J multiplied by R. And just like bending, J and R, they are expressed in terms of D. So at the end of the day, once you solve this equation, your tau is going to be in terms of D. So please understand, at this point, we are not substituting the numbers for tau and sigma. We are just trying to find out the value of sigma in terms of D, finding out the value of tau in terms of D. Now here comes the fun part, because since sigma and tau are acting simultaneously, you would have something called as the principal stresses. And principal stress equation, we are only looking at the maximum principal stress, which will be sigma plus square root of sigma plus 4 tau square. So this is the principle of sigma p. This will be equated to sigma design. And then you will find out the value of D. Now, this procedure may seem complex, but once you work out a few problems, it actually not. So first we find out the resultant bending moment. We find out the value of sigma in terms of the unknown, which is D. Then we find out the resultant twisting moment. Then we find out the resultant shear stress in terms of diameter. And at the end, we find out the principal stress. And the principal stress is nothing but the combination of sigma and tau, where sigma is the bending stress and tau is the shear stress. And this entire equation will be in terms of D, that will be equated to sigma design. So this will be equated to the known value. Same thing, we are going to find out the maximum shear stress. And maximum shear stress is given as 1/2 sigma square plus 4 tau square root. And again, this entire expression will be in terms of D, and then tau max in terms of D will be equated to tau design. And depending upon how simple or complex the problem is, you may have to work out this problem in trial using some trial and error, or you have to use your calculator to solve the equation. Now, this is the classical process. So if you were to look at the problems solved in the textbook, sure, you can actually use this problem and then work out the answer. But you will realize that if the problem loadings are constant, complicated, or varying, then the problem becomes sort of difficult to solve. Now let me give you a shortcut method. Now here is an alternate method, and I plan on using this method all the time. So what is the key takeaway from this technique? Key takeaway is we are going to find the diameter using two techniques. We are going to find out the diameter using the principal stresses. We are going to find out the diameter using the shear stresses. And at this time, we are going to have two values. And out of those, since we are designing, we will pick up the larger value. So if we find the diameter is equal to maybe 20 millimeters from the principal stress equation, and if we find the diameter is equal to 30 millimeters from the maximum shear stress equation, naturally we are going to have our diameter, or we are going to select the shaft diameter to be 30 millimeters because that is the larger value. You will find out for shaft design, almost always based on the shear criteria, which is the tau max criteria, gives you the larger diameter. And here's the logic for that. If you look at the bending stress, design bending stress is nothing but the tensile strength or the compressive strength of the material. Design bending strength is the tensile strength or the compressive strength of the material. It is going to be minimum 2 times the shear stress. So basically, tensile stress will be greater than the shear stress. Compressive stress is going to be greater than shear stress. So if you were to decide designing of shaft is based on the shear criterion, you might as well skip one step. So this gives us a simplified process. So here is the simplified process. Simplified process for shaft design under combined load. In this process, similar to the previous one, you will find out the maximum bending moment. This is the resultant bending moment, which is maximum. And you may have to use the bending moment in the vertical direction or bending moment in the horizontal direction, and then you find the resultant. You would find out the maximum torque. So this comes from the power transmission. And speed. So you will find out the maximum bending moment and maximum torque. And I'm going to denote this as M and going to T. And I'm going to find out the value of T equivalent. T equivalent is nothing but the square root of M square plus T square. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to find out the resultant value of T equivalent, which is the square root of moment square and torsion twisting square. And here is the logic for this particular problem. If you look at the shaft, the shaft has three planes and three axes. So you have T that is acting over here. And you have M that is because of the bending moment, which could be clockwise, counterclockwise over here. So these two guys give you bending moment. And this guy about Z gives you twisting moment. Now I want you to visualize this and notice that the plane in which the torque is acting, the plane where the torque is acting, and I want to show you that plane for a second. So this is the plane in which torque is happening. Torque is perpendicular to the xx plane, or x, oh, this is y, y, x, x. So if you look at the bending moment and twisting moment, they are perpendicular to each other. So this gives me an assumption, since these both of these are moments. So there is a bending moment and there's a twisting moment. Since these two moments are perpendicular to each other, I would just find out the resultant. And then once I find the resultant, I will use the same equation for the shaft design. TEQ divided by J multiplied by R, and I will find out the result, the answer for the diameter. So based on this value, I will find out the value of diameter. This process is very straightforward, and you can extend this process for the principal stresses as well. But the only issue there you will observe is shaft design, the diameter that you get from twisting, or tau is equal to TEQJ multiplied by R, will be greater than the diameter that you get from the principal stress or bending stress analysis. So this is a simplified process, and I would be using this process because, as you can see, here you don't have any approximations. You don't have to solve quadratic or cubic equations, and this process works out very well, even if you have the circular shaft that is hollow, or the circular shaft that is solid. Okay, now I'm going to work out a couple of problems. Any questions before we begin? Okay, let me work out the problem. And please remember this process, because this process will be used almost all the times in gear designs. It will be used when we design the shafts for internal combustion engines and so on. Okay, so design a solid circular shaft. That is subjected to the bending moment of 3 kilonewton meter, and torque of 10 kilonewton meter. So you have a shaft that is subjected to the bending moment of 3 kilonewton meter and twisting moment of 10 kilonewton meter, and the ultimate shear stress, and please note here the difference, this is ultimate shear stress, is equal to 500 megapascals. So ultimate shear stress is 500 megapascals. Factor of safety is equal to 6. So we have to find out the diameter of the shaft. So first and foremost, we have to find out the tau design, or the torsional strength, 500 divided by 6. That gives me 83.3. Newton per millimeter squared. As megapascal, it's same as Newton per millimeter squared. Next thing is the bending moment is given, the twisting moment is given. I'm going to find out the equivalent stress, equivalent torque. TEQ is equal to M squared plus T squared. And M square is 3 square, T square is 10 square square root. When we do that, we get 10.44 kilonewton meter. Now, what we need to do is we have to use the equation tau is equal to T divided by J multiplied by R. This is 83.3. T is 10.44, 10 to power 6, divided by pi d raised to 4, pi 32, d by 2, and d, once you solve this equation, is equal to 86 millimeter, can say this is 90 millimeter. So this is the process for design of shafts. Now let me take one more example that will make this concept clear. Next problem. A shaft is supported in the bearings as shown. So shaft so if you look at the shaft this is how the shaft looks like and there is a gear over here This distance is 100. This distance is 100. And if you look at the weight of the gear, So the total force that is weight plus transmission force is given as 3.3 kilonewton. And we will talk about this in just a second. And the torque that is transmitted by gear is 0.23 kilonewton meter. So what this problem talks about is on this configuration, you have a shaft and you have a gear. The total downward force on this gear is 3.3 kilonewton. And the total torque that is transmitted by this shaft is 0.23 kilonewton meter. Now, what we want to do is we want to find out total the T equivalent and let me write down the equation for T equivalent on the side m square plus T square so torque is given to us somehow we have to find out the bending moment once we find the bending moment we have to find out the equivalent torque so if you were to draw the free body diagram is going to look like forces shown like this 3.3 kilonewton going down this is at the center span which is half of the shaft distance so this is going to be 3.3 by 2 this is going to be 3.3 by 2 and the bending moment is going to be maximum at the center span so m is going to be 3.3 divided by 2 multiplied by 100 divided by 1000 kilonewton meter, because this value is in kilonewton and the distance in the millimeter is converted to meter. So this value is kilonewton meter, and my answer is 170.17 kilonewton meter. So T equivalent is equal to square root of m square plus 0.23 square. That gives me the total torque, which is 0.29 kilonewton meter. So I can use the equation tau is equal to TEQ divided by J multiplied by R, and value of I'm gonna say tau is given as 45 newton per millimeter square. This is the design. So this is 45, 0.29, 10 to power 6, pi d raised to 4 by 32, d by 2. And you can solve this and get the value of d. That is about 32 millimeters. So you can modify that to 35 millimeter, because 35 millimeter is a standard shaft size. Okay, any questions here? Everybody understood the procedure for shaft design? Now, Dr. Sushil is going to talk about the design of couplings, but let me set the stage for design of couplings. So if you want to join two shafts, here is the easiest way to connect them together. You can actually have a sleeve so you can actually construct, can have shaft one, can have shaft two. And if you look at, there will be a sleeve. And then what you can do is, you can use maybe set screws or some other means to make sure that the sleeve remains in firm contact with the shaft. For small power transmission, a set screw type of mechanism would work, or you could have some sort of a cutout in the shaft. You could have a D shaft, wherein if you look at the end of the shaft, it's something like this, and your set screw actually goes and fits into the groove on the shaft. So what you do is, for small power transmission, you could have shaft one, you could have shaft two, and you could have a sleeve. Now, so design process is pretty much similar to what we talked about. So you can design shaft one or shaft two using the technique that we talked about. And assuming this is a solid shaft, you got the diameter D. Now for the sleeve, think about what the sleeve looks like. So sleeve is actually nothing but a short distance hollow shaft. So if you think about the sleeve is nothing but hollow shaft. So you can use the same principles that we used so far and design this hollow shaft the purpose of this hollow shaft is to wrap around or to connect shaft 1 to shaft 2 by means of some sort of joining mechanism, maybe a set screw, or sometimes you can use a key. So you will have shaft. On this shaft, you are going to cut a groove. And then what you will have is you will have a metallic piece, small metallic piece that sits in this groove and that is attached to the sleeve internally. So you could have, so if you look at the side view, you will have the shaft, you'll have the key, half of the key will go in the shaft, half of the key will go in the coupling. So the power transmission is going to take place from shaft to key and from key to coupling. So this is called as a simple muff coupling. There's a key, or there could be a set screw. And there are variations of this. So if you want to make this compliant, so if you want to account for slight variation in the angles, or maybe there is little offset, you can actually add cutouts. So that way this muff coupling becomes like a sort of a spring. So key stress, key would have shear stresses. So basically, if you look at the failure of the key, you have this shaft. And then you have the coupling. So the shaft is trying to cut through this key. So if you think about it, there are two ways the key can fail. Key can fail in shear, or key can fail in crushing. And basically, you can see these two different types of failures. For example, what happens is key gets spliced, or key gets crushed and the transmission gets jammed. But in design, key is used as a mechanical fuse. So just like electrical fuse, when the power transmission exceeds the rated capacity of the elements, for example, either prime mover or the load, you don't want prime mover to break down. You don't want load to break down. What you have is you have this sort of a mechanical fuse that is in between the power transmission from prime mover to the pump or to a load. And that gets broken deliberately. So this is something called as the fail-safe design. So by design, you allow this key to fail at certain overload case. And that way, what you can do is, if something were to fail, you just replace the key, fix it, or just clean it up, clean the keyway, put a new key, and then you are ready to go. And these different failures of key, different failures of muff, they will be discussed when you discuss the shaft and key design. Sometimes there is one additional aspect to the shaft, the muff design, is you would have a flange. So think about it, you have, and this is a very common type of coupling that is used for large power transmission. You might have seen this. So you have sort of a flange. So you have shaft on one side you have shaft on the other side, you have a key, then you have key here, and then these two halves of the coupling are bolted together. So there is a bolt here. So this is called as the flange coupling. And design of flange coupling is again based on the torsional stresses that we talked about. So remember this, that this is how the couplings can be designed. So when you study the keys and couplings, you will talk, you will study how the keys are sized, then how, what are the different types of keys, how the fitting takes place, what are the different types of couplings, how can couplings be used to minimize the offset, how can you compensate for different misalignment issues, and so on. But this coupling, design of coupling, comes from the shaft design. So shaft design is the basis that is used for coupling design. Any questions? I think I answered Borna's question, but if there are any other questions, I would be happy to answer. Now, next thing I want to talk about is design of clutches. So the concept that we discuss here is very important when you design clutches. So I don't know if you have seen how the clutch looks like. Think about it like you have two circular plates. So there is a circular plate here. And the shaft is attached to this circular plate. This circular plate is called as the clutch plate. And maybe this is an electric motor. So this is the clutch plate. And this is the electric motor. Now, what I want to show you is this clutch plate has a matching or mating plate. So which means there is another plate over here. But the difference between this plate is capable of sliding back and forth on the shaft. So if you think about it, what this plate is, this plate has sort of splines. So you have spline shaft. So splines are sort of grooves. And this clutch plate is capable of sliding back and forth on this shaft. So there are splines, and I'm going to show you splines over here. So this is spline shaft. And this is movable plate. And then at the end, this shaft is attached to the load. So this is load. This is electric motor. This is clutch plate. And the whole thing could be situated inside a housing, could be filled with oil and so on. And the faces where these sort of attach to each other, you have frictional surface. So you have friction. Now, I want you to think about it. When this movable plate, when this movable plate is in firm contact with the plate on the left-hand side, when the movable plate is where it actually makes sure that it's making a proper contact with the clutch plate. this is called as a stationary flip. So let me write this on stationary. So you have a stationary plate on the left hand side, and you have the moving plate on the right hand side. So what happens is the stationary plate is held fixed or attached firmly to the movable plate. And there are different ways of achieving this, and I will talk about it in just a second. And what happens is when these two plates are in firm contact, when these two plates are in firm contact, the power from the electric motor gets transmitted to the load. For some reason, if this movable plate slides away from the stationary plate, and this distance could be as low as a millimeter. This doesn't have to be a large shift. There doesn't have to be a large distance between these two plates. Then the power transmission will be halted. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that movable plate gets in contact, a firm contact with the stationary plate when we want for power transmission. There are two ways to do this. One thing is you can attach springs. So you could have springs that could sit in the groove, and these springs can basically push this movable plate away from the stationary plate. So you can use some sort of springs to maintain the constant pressure. So springs can provide contact force. Or what you can have is you can have an electromagnet. This is how the air conditioning systems in the car work. So you could have an electromagnet, and what happens is you energize the electromagnet. Once you energize the electromagnet, the magnetic element in the movable plate gets in firm contact with the stationary plate. And as long as the electromagnetic is energized, the power gets transmitted. So if you were to turn on your air conditioner, you would see most of the times electromagnetic gets turned on, the moving plate gets attached to the stationary plate, which is on the clutch pulley, and your air conditioning compressor starts rotating. If you were to switch off the air conditioner, basically you are de-energizing the coil, electromagnetic coil, this coil, and that way the moving plate can leave the contact, and moving plate and the stationary plate has some teeny tiny distance, and then the compressor air conditioner stops. Most of the times, the failure in the air conditioning system occurs because the coil gets burnt out. And this happens in certain cases. Typically, the compressors are designed to last for a long time. So that's why what they do is when air conditioning system is not working, first they see if there is voltage at the coil, and if there is appropriate adequate voltage, 13 volts or 14.5 volts, depending upon how the system is designed, you can, instead of replacing the whole compressor, you can just replace the coil and your air conditioning system starts working again. But here is something that usually happens. All of a sudden, if there is additional load on the air conditioning system, the amount of contact force that is needed to run the compressor at higher power exceeds the design criteria for the electrical coil, which means the coil will draw more current than it is designed because it is expected to provide more force. And electromagnetic force is depending upon the amount of current and number of coils to the conductor. Number of coils are constant. So if there is additional cooling capacity required, coil, there is higher current voltage is also fixed by the battery voltage. The amount of current to the coil exceeds the capacity of the coil. There is excess heat that is generated, and the coil gets burnt and coil gets short, and the air conditioning stops working. So that is potentially the failure of your air conditioning system. In the case of spring-loaded clutches, many a times what could happen is the springs may not be able to give enough load, or maybe suddenly subjected to impact loadings. So the loading is impact and could lead to breakage, and the clutch stops working. That can happen in the manual car. So this is the example of single plate clutch. Single plate clutch has limited power transmission capability. If you want more power to be transmitted, that is always the case in the case of cars, you would use multi-plate clutch. So rather than one plate, you will have multiple plates that are coming in contact, and you will have one stationary plate attached to the other moving plate, and so on. So you want to design a multi-plate clutch system that would be used for power transmission. So what is the fundamental equation for clutch design? So if you think about the clutch design, let's try to talk about a very simple case. And I'm going to show a hypothetical exercise. So what we have is we have two plates, but the power transmission is vertical. So I want you to think about this particular case. And this is the basis of clutch design. So you have an electric motor, and there is a torque that is supplied. And on this, you have the vertical shaft, and maybe this vertical shaft is connected to some sort of a machine, maybe a drill machine, some sort of machine. And here is this clutch. So I want you to think about, if this electrical motor rotates, if there is torque T, as long as I'm going to call this top plate is in contact with the bottom plate, do you agree with me that this torque will get transmitted? So which means, as long as the top plate is in contact with the bottom plate, the electrical motor will transmit torque to the machine. Now, one thing that's possible is if electrical motor starts spinning fast, there could be some inertial forces, and this contact may not be continuous, which means the top plate will sort of go up and down. And in that case, there's interruption of contact, and there will be intermittent power transmission. So what I can do is, now I want you to think about this, I can add a spring here. I can add a spring here. This spring is sitting around the shaft, but the purpose of the spring is to apply a continuous force so that the top plate is in contact with the bottom plate. Now, I want you to understand the concept of clutching and declutching. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to attach this spring to a lever. I'm going to attach this spring to a lever. And what I want to do is, when I want to declutch, I'm going to press this lever down. When I want to declutch, I'm going to press this lever down. And clearly, this is a larger lever arm. So there will be a force multiplication, which means the force applied to the spring will be significantly higher, and the spring will be compressed. And when the spring will be compressed, when the spring will be moving upwards, when spring is moved upwards, then the top plate will no longer be in contact with the bottom plate, and that the torque transmission will be interrupted. This is how a very simple torque transmission work. Now let's find out what is the transmission capacity of this system. So if the force applied, so think about it like this is the top clutch plate, and the force applied by the top clutch plate is F. And let's assume that this force is applied uniformly. Maybe this force is applied uniformly at radius, which is R. This force is applied uniformly at radius R. The coefficient of friction is mu, which means the frictional force is going to be mu times F. So the torque transmission, if you look at the distance, which is R, so torque capacity, this is important, this is torque capacity is equal to mu times F multiplied by R, where F is the force that is applied by the spring, mu is the coefficient of friction between the moving plate and the fixed plate, and R is the radius where the force is being applied. So if the torque capacity is greater than the torque that is transmitted by the electric motor, the power transmission will work without any problem. Now, for some reason, if the torque needed or torque that needs to be transmitted exceeds the torque capacity, then the power transmission will be intermittent. This is exactly similar to an example. Imagine that you are driving your vehicle on a nice road. This is a road. So there is no slippage because the interface between road and tire is able to provide the traction. So basically, the interface between tire and road is going to support the traction. So the road is capable of transmitting the torque that is needed. So there is enough traction. Now think about it, that all of a sudden there is water. So as soon as there is water, the coefficient of friction drops down, which means the traction between the road and the tire is reduced and the vehicle starts hydroplaning, which means it is not possible to sustain the forward motion of the car because the interface is not capable of supporting the torque that is required. So that is the fundamental principle of power transmission using clutches. So the important elements of clutch, they are clutch plate and springs. So clutch plates are designed based on the torque capacity. And I just want to give you a simple example. If you think about the clutch plate, what is a clutch plate? If you think about a clutch plate is nothing but a short hollow shaft. So just think about it. If you want to design a clutch plate, think about that you have a long shaft and you are taking a slice of that shaft. So this clutch plate is again based on the design of hollow shaft. But what you do is the torque that is needed for the clutch design comes from this equation. And so this is used to design the plate. And this F, this total equation is used to design the plate. And this F is used to design the springs. And believe it or not, when you look at the spring design, springs, if you think about it, springs, if you apply the force, the springs rotate about their center line. So in other words, the spring design is also based on the shaft, so torque design. So basically, the equation that you use for spring design, they are also based on the shaft design. How does the equation for the shaft design? So the topic that we studied today forms a basis when we design the clutches and when we design springs. So when we discuss the design of clutches, when we discuss the design of springs, I want you to go back to this discussion. And then what we can do is we can just start with the design process for springs, design process for clutches, and complete the design without looking at the theory of the shaft design or torsional stresses. Okay, any questions here? So design of clutches, design of springs. Are based on the concepts that we discussed in today's class. And if you look at the video lectures that are uploaded on the Canvas, some additional video lectures that are included, they talk about the clutch design and spring design. But if you really want to find out, you are welcome to read through the book, and it will give you a design process for the clutches and springs that can be followed if you have a spring design or a clutch design problem. Any questions here? Okay, if there are no questions, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start the next topic. The next topic is the design of quarter joint. So the next topic is design of quarter joints. So just like a coupling, quarter joint is used to join rods. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show a three-dimensional view of the quarter joint. I would explain the function or how the quarter joint works. And this is truly a system design problem, because if you think about it, you have multiple elements that work together that actually they are part of the system. So this is called as the spigot. And this spigot goes into something called as the socket. So this is socket, and let me show you the inside view of the socket. This socket, and again on the socket there's a hole. So through this hole a cotter goes in. So what you have is you have the spigot end that fits perfectly in the socket end, and through the holes there is cotter. So if you look at the front view, so if you look from here, you will observe that you have this rod. And there is a cotter that goes in here. So this is the cotter. So what is the use of cotter joint? So if you have the reciprocating motion on the spigot end, so if you think about it, the spigot end is connected to a crosshead, or spigot end is connected to some sort of a mechanism that is going back and forth. So this spigot end will go forward and backward. That forward and backward motion will be transmitted through the cotter to the socket end. So cotter joint is used to transmit forces. So there are some important dimensions of the cotter joint, and then what I'm going to do is let me give you the basic geometry of the cotter joint, and then what we can do is we can look at how the cotter joint is designed depending upon the failure. So when there is the design of cotter joint, what they will do is they will give you the load to be transmitted. So P is the load to be transmitted. And they will give you the value of tensile stress, tensile strength. Compressive or crushing strength, and shear strength. Now, depending upon what type of materials that are used, the material for cotter could be different for material for socket and spigot. So if the cotter is made with a different material, then you will have the values of the material for cotter, and you will have the values or the material for spigot, socket. So now what we want to do is, we are given this external load P, and we want to design these different cross sections to make sure that this cotter joint is able to sustain the external load. So what we want to do is we want to look at the different failure modes, and then that way we will be able to design the important dimensions of the quarter joint. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a break of 15 minutes because I would like to finish the quarter joint in one session. So we'll take a break for 15 minutes and then we'll talk about the design of quarter joint. I believe your quiz one is on the design of quarter joint. So what we are going to discuss in the last part of this class will be important from the quiz point of view. So I'll give you a break for 15 minutes and we can start after the break and discuss design of quarter joint. So what we are trying to do is we are going to apply the load P and find out the dimensions at various sections of this joint by analyzing the type of failure mode that this joint will be exposed to. So for example, if there is a compressive failure, if there is compressive load, or if there is tensile load, we expect the joint to fail in tension or compression. So what we do is we design the diameter, this diameter, in tension or compression. If you look at the quarter, this quarter is similar to the problem that you worked out in your homework one. So there could be shearing happening over here. So there could be some shear taking place for the quarter. So what we are going to do is we are going to go systematically, step by step, and then find out these various dimensions. So let's start with the first step. Design of rod end. So if you think about the rod end, this is that dimension. And this is direct failure, tension or compression. So you will have, I'm going to say, assume tension, sigma t is equal to p divided by pi by 4 d square. So value of p is known, value of sigma t for the Sigot is given, Sigot material. So from here you can find out the value of diameter. Step 2. And if you look at, if you want to show the failure cross section, this would be the failure cross section. Step 2. If you want to find out the spigot diameter, so this is the spigot diameter. This spigot diameter is called as D1. So what I want you to do is, I want you to look at the cross-sectional area XX. And you will notice that this cross-section area is something like this. And this is the area that is actually failing. Now here, there is a little bit of a chicken and egg problem. Because here, this T is the thickness of the cotter, and this D is the diameter of the spigot end. So if you look at the resisting area is pi by 4 D1 square minus D1 times T. So sigma T is equal to P divided by pi by 4 D1 square minus D1T. Here are two unknowns. So we cannot solve those two unknowns with one equation. So what we need to do is we need to go to the next step and then come back. So let's add next step. Step three, which is design of cotter in double shear. So if you look at the socket spigot joint, you have cotter that is here. And this cotter will be sliced off, will be sheared at two locations. So what we want to do is we want to find out the failure area for cotter. Now, if you look at the cotter double shear, this distance is tau is equal to P divided by 2 times L times T, where L is the length of the cotter joint. So if you look at the cotter, this is the length of the cotter joint. So length of the cotter. So if you look at the area, is L times T. But unfortunately, you know you have T, but we do not have the value of L. So let's go to the next step. So that is crushing of cotter. So sigma C is equal to P divided by D1 times T. So if you look at the crushing area of the cotter, this is the area in which the cotter would get crushed. So it is interesting to note that sigma C value is given, value of P. And then we can use this D1 times T in step two to find D1. So let me repeat once again. So at the end of step four, we are gonna have the result for D1 multiplied by T. Now we don't know what the value of D1 is. We don't know what the value of T is, but we know that D1 times T is nothing but P divided by sigma C for cotter. So this is sigma C value for cotter. And then what we do is we actually substitute this value, that will go in this equation. Please note, this value comes from step 4. And once you have step 4, value of d1 is known. Once the value of d1 is known, value of t is known. Once the value of t is known, you can substitute this value of t in this expression, and value of L is known. So we will have to go a little bit back and forth. First, we have to find out the value for the product d1 times t. Then we are looking at the value of d1 times t that will give us the value of d1. Once we have the value of d1, then we can find out the value of t. And once we have that value, then we substitute it back and then get the value of L. So that way, at this point, we have all the major components of spigot and Cotter done. What we need to do next, the next step, is finding out the spigot extension. So what is the spigot extension? So if you look at the spigot, the Cotter is going to sit here. And this length is called as the spigot extension, which is called as L2. And what happens is, you can think about it, that the socket is going to pull the Cotter towards right hand side. Socket is going to pull the Cotter towards left hand side. That may cause spigot to slice off. So if you look at the failure, this failure is in double shear. So tau is equal to E divided by 2 times d1 l2. Notice this diameter is d1. So basically, you are looking at something. So let me show you in 3 dimension. So you could have this small piece that would just come out because Cotter got pulled in this direction. So value of d1 is known, value of p is known, tau is given. With this, you are able to find out value of L2. Next step, step 6. Is we have to find out socket collar dia. So we are interested in this diameter. This d4. And this is designed in crushing. So sigma c is equal to p divided by d4 minus d1 multiplied by t. Please note, t is the thickness of Cotter, this is known. D is a Spigot diameter that is known. Sigma C is given. So the only unknown in this expression is D4, and that gives you the value of socket collar dia. Step 7. Is collar width. So this collar width is nothing but this. And think about it, this is like a ring that can come up. So collar width is given as it's a double shear because the cotter can actually slice this collar. So tau is equal to P divided by 2 times D4 minus D1 times L4. So please note, there is this difference. Since it's in shear, even though the equation may look similar, but they are not. So what you do is substitute the values. Value of P is known. Value of D4 is known. Value of D1 is known. The only unknown in this equation is L4. Step 8 is socket diameter. And that is the direct tension failure. Which is sigma t is equal to p divided by pi by 4 t3 square minus d1 square t3 minus d1 p. And let me show you what dimension is this. This dimension is this guy. Step 9 is socket thickness. And this socket thickness is calculated using circumferential shear. So if you think about the socket, the rod end can actually come out. So this thickness is found using the circumferential shear. So tau is equal to P divided by pi D 1 L3. So value of P is given, tau is given, D1 is known. So from here, value of L3 can be found out. The next step is Spigot कॉलर डाया स्टेप 10 and that is designed in crushing. So sigma c is equal to p divided by pi by 4 t2 square minus t1 square. Here p is known, t1 is known, only unknown is g2. And in case if you are wondering what dimension is this, this is the dimension d2. The last step, step 11, is spigot collar thickness, and this dimension we call L6, and that is based on the circumferential shear. And the last step is you can check cotter for bending. So these are about 11 steps. One thing I want you to understand that these steps will give you major dimensions. So they are not going to give you all the dimensions of the cotter joint. So if you were to look at the diagram that is given in the book, most like your 90% of the dimensions you should be able to find. However, later what you can do is you can actually use those basic dimensions and use the guidelines that are provided in design data book or the reference dimensions that are discussed in the textbook and draw this joint. And when you start drawing, you will realize that you will need some more dimensions, and those will be decided based on engineering judgment. So initially to start with, you need to start with a simple sketch. And as you start converting that sketch into an engineering drawing, you will have to make some assumptions, use engineering judgment, and add additional dimensions. But with these dimensions, you should be able to finish the CAD model using SolidWorks or CATIA or Autodesk Inventor. And then you should be able to do FEA analysis on some of these parts. Now, one thing I just want to tell you that I have said 3D printing, but 3D printing is optional. Because sometimes, and you can build a scale model. So you can build a 1/2 scale model of a cotter joint if you want to in the quiz. 3D printing is optional. And the reason for that is, so that way you will get a feel for how the cotter, spigot, and socket, they fit together. But that is purely optional. So you can use Innovation Hub, or you can use, if you have a 3D printer at home, you're welcome to build a scale model of a 3D printer, but that is optional. Let me quickly go through the steps once again. So cotter joint is used for joining two rods and to transmit tensile or compressive forces. And then what we need to do is we have to use the simple design equations that we studied in last class and today to gradually, step by step, add more components to it. So to design the components, we look at the failure modes of rod end, spigot diameter, cotter, use the simple equations for area, and then find out the unknown values. Again, there are more than one method to find all the dimensions. So if you look at the textbook, the steps might be different, but at the end, your dimensions should be the same. So what I would encourage you to do is look at the solution that is posted on the canvas. In the video lectures, I have actually solved one quarter joint, and I have uploaded the solutions for quarter joint. Just it would be sort of plug and get the values and then draw the quarter joint. So with this, I'm going to stop here. And if you have any questions, I would be happy to answer.